Hello everyone. Today I'm going to discuss about the chest pain, how we are going to assess the chest pain, how we are going to do differentially diagnose the chest pain. So in this topic, I'm going to discuss about the what is the chest pain, what are the different types of the chest pain, what are the cause to factors, that is etiological factors and characteristics of the cardiac chest pain. So the chest pain due to ischemic cardiac pain and also non-ischemic cardiac pain and non-cardiac cause to factors. So we have to discuss about the differential diagnosis. So what are the other cause to factors may give the chest pain? So which one is the cardio-related chest pain or non-cardio-related chest pain? So these things we are going to discuss in this topic. So if you see that, what is the basic the terms, the chest pain? What is the definition of the chest pain? The general term for the full dull or any dull aching pain in the thorax. So if any pain in the chest regions, it can be either cardiac pain or non-cardiac pain, it is called as chest pain. Any pain related in the chest region. So sometimes, so it may be because of the cardiac related problem or because of some other non-cardiac problems also may produce the chest pain. So why we have to do this assessment plan, why we have to do the differential diagnosis to rule out the cause to factor for the chest pain. So nowadays many people are facing this problem if they're having small like a pain because of the gastric like a irritation also. If they feel the pain in the chest, so they may worry about that. So they are going to be get the heart attack or may chance to get the, they may chance to die. So this is, that's the reason we have to rule out. So which cause to factors may produce the chest pain or heart attack, or which cause to factors may give the musculoskeletal or maybe because of the some other non-cardiogenic muscular like a chest pain. So that's the reasons. So we have to check the, give the full assessment about the chest pain. So according to the classification of the New York Heart Association functional classifications, so it is classified into the four categories. So in the category one, no limitation during the ordinary activities. So during the functional activities or if any activities, if no like a limitations, but they're going to feel the pain, but it won't restrict any functional activities, any ordinary activities. Second category, slight the limitation during the ordinary activity. So it may alter their functional activities, may disturb the functional activities. The slightly, not much severe, that is a grade 2 or class 2 chest pain. And also class 3 is the marked limitation of the normal activities without symptoms at rest. So that means they are going to restrict their movements, their normal activities. So without the symptoms at the rest, so they won't get any symptoms. If they actively participate their activities, so they may restrict the symptoms or restrict the functional activities. So that is the class 3. So coming to the class 4, so it's going to be the unstable to undertake the physical activity. So that means unable to do the physical activity. So if they do any activities, it may restrict the functional activities. So without symptoms, symptoms may be present at rest. So and also in the physical activities, so they may restrict the movement and also they are going to get the symptoms the present at the rest also. So this class is called as the fourth grade class. So this is according to the New York Heart Association functional classification. So what are the cause to factors? So many cause to factors for the chest pain. So these are the cardiogenic cause to factors and also non-cardiac cause to factor. So cardiogenic or is a cardio-related cause to factors are myocardial ischemia or any trauma. The myocardial ischemia means if the decrease the blood circulation to the myocardium, that is the cardiac muscles, may chance to get the heart attack and also gives the chest pain. Or in case of if any trauma to the in the heart, or maybe if any injury, or maybe is because of any fat accumulation inside the heart, or if related to the conducting system of the heart failure, so may chance to get the heart attack symptoms. And also another cause to factor is angina pectoris. Angina pectoris also one of the cause to factor for the chest pain. So this is nothing but is the decrease the blood circulation to the cardiac muscles. Also this is the angina pectoris. So this again divided into the stable angina and also unstable angina. maybe in the other classes you are going to discuss in the detail. So in the about the stable angina, also unstable angina, and also acute coronary syndromes. So acute coronary syndromes relate to the coronary artery, any blockage, any thrombus formation, or any like a occlusion in case of the coronary arteries also. So they may chance to get the chest pain. So these are the major cause to factors for the is the chest pain. These are related to the cardiogenic cause to factor. Coming to the non-cardiogenic cause to factor, so not related to the cardiac, so that means not related to the heart. This is going to be related to the maybe blood vessels, are related to the heart, but it's not purely to the like a heart or muscles and also heart pumping action. But these are going to be the another cause for aortic stenosis. Aorta is the major blood vessel in the heart, which is connected to the heart, and also it supplies the blood circulation throughout the body and also through the distributed arteries. So if any obstruction or if narrowing of the blood vessel, so that is called as the aortic stenosis. So and also one more cause to factor is aortic dissections. So aortic dissection means if you see in the aorta is a major blood vessel, largest artery in our body. So this also having the major layers, that is the this blood vessel form with the three layers: tunica intima, tunica media, and tunica externa. So these layers, if any damage in the these layers, if any opening of the blood vessels or any breakage or any damage in the aortic blood vessels, so may chance to get the leaking. So they may chance to get the chest pain. That also one of the cause factor. The dissections like, so if you see here, the aortic dissection is going to be the opening of the aorta or maybe damage or breakage of the aorta. So may gain chance to get the bleeding of the aorta. So this going to be classified into the like a two categories, and also is a type 1 and also type 2 and sorry three category type 3. So these are going to be depends upon the site, depends upon the distance, and depends upon the like a space. So it's going to be vary. So coming to the pericarditis, so inflammation of the pericardium, the surrounding layer of the heart, the protecting layer of the heart, so is called as the pericardium. So if the pericardium is going to be if inflammation, so may chance to get the chest pain. Pulmonary embolism. Embolism means if any like a blood clot, if any breakdown, the blood clot is called as thrombus. If the breakage of the thrombus, if thrombus is traveled from one place to another place in the bloodstream, so if they stuck at one particular place, so this traveling of the blood clot to one place is called as the embolus formations. So if this embolus in the pulmonary, especially the pulmonary artery and also vein, so it may give the like a non-cardiogenic chest pain. And also pulmonary hypertension, if any increasing the blood pressure in the pressure in the pulmonary vessels, so also one of the cause to factor for the chest pain. And also pneumonia, so it's nothing but is the inflammation of the lung inside the, and also pleuritis, the covering layer of the lung, also called as pleura. If any inflammation of the pleura or if any inflammation of the lung structure, so may chance to get the tightness and also may chance to produce the heart pain or chest pain. And also spontaneous hypertension. So if any hypertension, if the sudden changes in the blood pressure, so also may chance to get the like increasing the pressure in the chest and also may chance to get the chest pain. Usaphasal and reflex. So that is related to the if any reflex are in the gastric pain, if any gas problem, so if it is pushed the pressure towards the usaphagus into the sternum in the chest regions, so if any gastric irritation in the stomach, so if the usaphasal reflex, so it may produce it, regurgitate to the upwards, so they may chance to get the pain in the chest, burning pain may chance to get in the chest. So that also looks like is the chest pain. So many people are confused, are going to, so because of the gastric pain also, so they feel that they may having the some cardiac chest pain. And also next one is the usaphagosal spasm. So spasm also because of the muscle tightness in the usaphagus. Usaphagus has the smooth muscles, so these smooth muscles are being helpful during the peristalsis of the movement, sending the digestion of the food. If any spasm, if any tightness of the this usaphagus muscle tightness also, if may restrict the movement or may produce the chest pain. The another cause to factor is a peptic ulcers. Peptic ulcers means nothing but is a gastric ulcers. Because of the irritation of the gastric mucosa or the stomach mucosa also may give the stomach pain. So especially who are having like a more like a intake of the like antacid, like intake of the NSAIDs, especially like a painkillers, or maybe stress, or depends upon the cause two factors. So they may chance to get the peptic ulcers. Peptic ulcer means the ulcer in the stomach mucosal wall. So this also may gives the irritation and also may chance to get the like a chest pain, or it gives the radiating pain also. And also gallbladder diseases, especially the gallbladder. So this also is a main like organ in our digestive system. So this also, if any stones or if any inflammation in the gallbladder also may send, they give the radiating pain in the chest region, also may cause to get the chest pain. And also musculoskeletal diseases, any spasm in the chest muscles, or if anybody like do improper activity, or maybe any exercises, improper exercises, or in the first initial starting exercises, maybe push-ups, or maybe with any other activities, maybe playing activities, also may chance to produce the muscle pain because of the strain. Also they may chance to get the stomach like it may chance to get the chest pain. And also herpes zoster is a viral infection. Because of the virus infection, so they may chance to get the burning pain in the chest. They may chance to get the rashes. Because of the rashes, they may give the radiating pain and burning pain in the chest region. And also emotional and also psychiatric conditions. Emotions, if they are having any depression, any anxiety, or if they heard any like a like any lovable people, any near and dear people having any health issues, if they heard about any serious history of the near and dear people, like a death news, may chance to get this type of non-cardiogenic chest pain also. So if they having like a emotional or if a psychological problem also, so because of that time the spasm, they may muscle spasm may chance to develop. So because of the muscle spasm, then they may chance to get the cardiac problem and also chest pain. Who are having the like a heart problems such as the angina, unstable angina, and also acute MI, myocardial infarctions, they are going to feel that the chest is going to be severe like a pressure. If someone is beating with a hammer, how they are going to feel? The same thing, the feeling is going to be happening in case of is a really cardio related the chest pain. And also they are going to get this heaviness and tightness, more pressure. If someone sit on the like a chest, so how we are going to feel? The same thing they are going to feel because of the cardiogenic chest pain. And also they are going to get the burning. So these are all like a special features. And also along with this one, they are going to get the other complications such as the vomiting sensation, have profuse sweating. And if someone is like a pulling with both sides of the any rope, how surrounding with how they are going to be squeeze the heart, so they are going to feel the type of symptoms because of the cardiogenic. And also only no tightness and also no like a squeezing one, only sharp like pain is going to be, we can commonly seen in the pericarditis, that is the inflammation of the pericardium. And also coming to the only burning sensations, so the burning sensation, there is no tightness, but they're going to feel the pain, but the pain will be the burning sensation is because of the esophageal reflex, peptic ulcers, and also herpes zosters. So in this condition, they won't feel the heaviness, they won't feel any tightness, they won't feel like anybody has like a beating with a hammer. They won't feel this one. So these are only there which will feel the burning sensation because of the burning. So it may give the irritation in the chest also, they feel the pain. So that is the difference between the cardiogenic pain and also other complications such as the gastric problems. And also the only burning pressure is going to the burning, but with the pressure is commonly seen in the gallbladder diseases. If any inflammation of the gallbladder, or if any stones, or if any infections, so it's going to give the chest pain, but the chest pain is going to be like a burning along with the pressure. But it's not going to be not heaviness, not as like a tightness. Pressure is there, burning also there. And also coming to the esophageal spasm, if any spasm in the esophageal muscles, the tightness, so they are going to get the pressure and tightness and burning. So here they are going to feel the tightness, but no heaviness, but here they are going to feel the tightness. But we have to differentiate, is there any pain, cardiogenic pain is going to be radiating to one place to another place, may distribute to the jaw, it may distribute to the neck region, it may distribute the shoulder. So we have to differentiate. So that's the reasons we have to understand all the types of the chest pain here, then we can easily differentially diagnose. So here they are going to get the only pressure, tightness and also burning in case of the esophageal muscle spasm. Next one is the pleuritic. The pleuritic means is inflammation of the pleura. So in this one is, so they are going to like a severe pain in the pleura. So it's going to the surrounding the chest regions, like it's a covering layer of the lungs. So if any space between the pleural space and also this pleura, if any the fluid, if any inflammations, so it may use the congestion. So they may chance to get in case of the pleural embolism, pneumonia, inflammation of the pleura, the spontaneous hypertension. So these are the causative factors for the pleuritic symptoms. And also the tearing and also ripping symptoms. So that means, so they are going to be in case of aortic dissections. So if any damage of the aorta, the largest blood vessel, so if any damage in opening, so they are going to feel the tearing and also ripping symptoms. And also aching type of pain. Is aching means like a pulling sensation, or only if we press the chest, if the tenderness is there. So if any with the activities, if any movement pain is there, so it's going to be related to the musculoskeletal. And also variables. So variable tables going to be emotional and psychiatric conditions. So sometimes if they have heard any sad news, if while crying, if they are very sad, so it may is going to get the heaviness of the chest, and also they feel the like a more discomfort in the chest. So it will be the variable. Sometimes in the relaxed time, if they relax, they are going to get the less like a compression, less the tightness. So these are going to be the different types of the chest pain. So major thing is, so which one is the cardiogenic and which one is the non-cardiogenic? If you understand clearly, we can clearly diagnose about the chest pain condition. So, and also next one is going to be how we are going to evaluate the patients. So this evaluation should be, so we have to evaluate clearly. Could the chest discomfort be due to an acute or potentially life-threatening conditions that warrants immediate hospitalization and also aggressive evaluations? If the person is chest discomfort, or suddenly if it is severe pain, if the person is like a life-threatening, so that means in case of the patient having chest pain, sweating, profuse sweating, and as the pain is radiating to the jaw and neck, and also left shoulder, in this condition, immediately have to shift the person to the hospital, and also they have to rule out aggressive evaluation should be there. So they have to go for some analysis, cardiac markers, and also blood test, and ECG, and Doppler. So all these tests are going to be evaluated the causative factors. So it may be because of the acute ischemic heart disease, so because of the decrease the blood supply to the heart muscles, aortic dissections, and also pulmonary embolism, spontaneous pneumothorax, if any air enter into the lung, so between the pleura and also lung, so it may give the serious complications. So in these conditions, so we have to rule out, so what is the causative factors. So if it is not serious one, so if not, could be discomfort due to the chronic conditions, so likely, so maybe it's a serious complication such as the stable angina. So angina because of the any blood accumulation, any restriction to the muscles of the heart, or maybe any aortic stenosis, if any aorta narrowing, or maybe is a thickness because of the aorta, or because of the there is no proper blood circulation in the aorta, or pulmonary hypertension, increasing the pressure in the pulmonary arteries and veins, so it may give the chest pain, so we can rule out. And also, if not, could the discomfort due to acute conditions? So sometimes they may chance to get acute conditions. So we have to rule out is because of the pericarditis, that is inflammation of the pericardium, or any pneumonia, any infection of the lungs, and also pleura, or if any viral infection such as the herpes zoster. So these are maybe acute conditions, but we have to differentiate with the cardiogenic causative factor and non-cardiogenic causative factor. So if not, put the discomfort due to the treatable chronic conditions. So sometimes who are having some gastric irritations or gastric problem is a chronic conditions. So these people, they may chance to get in the one period because of the depends upon the dietary and also depends upon their stress. So they may chance to get these gastric symptoms such as the esophageal reflex, spasm, peptic ulcer, or any and also gastrointestinal conditions and cervical disc diseases, arthritis of the shoulder spine, and also costochondritis, so musculoskeletal disorders, anxiety. So these, if not all, rule out the above conditions. So then we can think about the related to gastro irritations. So these are also chronic conditions. Maybe we have to rule out, is it because of the gastric problem or because of the esophageal reflex or muscular problem or tension. So then we can rule out, then according to the conditions, treatment plan be vary. So next one is, so just now we discussed that the angina is because of the any plaques in the blood vessels. So because of the plaques, the blood circulation is going to be decreased to the heart. So they may chance to get the angina symptoms or chest pain. And also, and one more thing, the cardiac dissections also is breakage in the cardiac, the aorta may produce the heart pain or chest pain. So initial evaluation of the suspected cardiac pain. So if it is suspected cardiac pain, so in case of severe pain, like a tightness, heaviness, is the beating like with a hammer or squeezing in between the any rope. So like this type of symptoms along with the vomiting sensation and also profuse sweating. And also, if any radiating pain to the neck, jaw, and shoulder, and back. So these, if anybody find like this type of symptoms, so the main important thing is, so we have to evaluate the condition as soon as possible. So here, so we have to check the crucial process and determine the nature and extent of the underlying heart disease. So what type of heart disease is there? So we have to rule out, and also risk of serious adverse events, any other serious adverse events are there, and according to that one, what is the management. So we have to start as soon as possible. So if anybody get the cardiac related chest pain, so here we have to rule out the in this one, so we have to check the what type of the pain here. So what type of the pain, what are the characteristics of the pain, so what characteristics. So, and where is the site? So, radiations. So, is there any radiating pain? Any provocations? So, any aggravating factors? Onset, how it started? And also associated features. So, these things we have to rule out. So, we are going to discuss one by one what is the characteristics of the pain and site, radiation and provocation, and also onset, associated features. So, coming to the associated, like a characteristics. So, what are the characteristics? So what type of character? So how the pain? So is it the dull, constricting, or choking, or heavy? So if the pain is going to be dull and also choking and also heavy, like a squeezing and crushing and also burning and also aching. So sometimes they may feel the how they beat with a hammer on the chest. So they are going to feel the that much of pain symptoms, and also breathlessness. So breathlessness because of the decrease of blood circulation. So may chance to get the breathlessness, or maybe it's a discomfort. So is along with if they're having any like a pallor, pale skin, heavy sweating, or nausea and vomiting, anxiety, crushing chest pain, breathing difficulty. So this type of characters they may chance to get during the chest pain. So we have to differentiate if anybody having these symptoms, so we can predict this having related to the cardiac chest pain. So coming to the site, so where exactly they're having the chest pain. So is it center of the chest, or is it because the right hypochondrium or left hypochondrium, or in the epigastric levels, or maybe in the left heart pain, or maybe right side. So it depends upon the site, so it may be is a vary. So if it's related to the like a chest or cardiac related to chest pain, so they are going to get the pain in the center of the chest here. So center of the chest, they're going to get the pain. So it's going to because of the derivation of the nerve supply to the heart and mediastin. So that is the sympathetic cardiac nerves, that is the T1 and T5, the mostly dorsal root going to be involved. So it's related to the center pain. So they're going to feel in the center. So in case of like in the gastric pain, it may alter, it may in the gastric, epigastric levels, but may the radiating pain may comes to the in the chest, in the upper chest, or maybe into the in the diaphragm region, in the may chance to get the left is the hypochondrium level. So these things are going to be happen. So and also next thing is we have to check about the radiation, radiating pain. So is it radiating pain? So radiation to the neck or jaw, upper, or even the arms also going to be affected. occasionally the site's radiation is going to be back also. So that means it's going to be the jaw, and also it's going to the neck region, and it's going to the back, and also it's going, mainly supply is going to the left shoulder. So because of the irritation of the nerve root, so may chance to get the left shoulder pain. So it's, if you see here, so the pain in the center, and it may affect to the jaw, and also affect to the left shoulder, and also affect to the epigastric level. So these we have to find out where the pain is radiating. So if you understand where exactly the radiation is there, so we can easily rule out the, is it the cardio-related cardiogenic chest pain or non-cardiogenic chest pain. So next one is the provocation. So this provocation is going to be, sorry, yeah, I'm sharing again. Okay, the provocation, the angina pain, or maybe the angina is going to be, so during the exertion and also promptly relieved by the rest. So if the anginal pain, so angina is due to decrease the blood circulation to the heart muscles. So because of these things, make use the chest pain. So during the exertion time, or is going to be promptly relieved by the rest. If they take the rest, they may chance to get the less pain. The pain may be is expedited by emotions, but occurs more is going to be is readily by the exertions. So or in case of the large meal or cold wind, also they are going to get the severe pain. So that is because of the anginal pain. So in case of like a MI, like in the myocardial infarctions, so they may they won't get any rest, the pain relief with the rest. But in the angina, they may chance to get the rest. And also in case of it may affect with the exertion and also large meal and also cold wind. And next one is the unstable angina, also the crescendo angina. So this also similar pain by the precipitated by the maximal exertion or at the rest. So they're going to get the pain in the exertion period, or may also in the rest also they may chance to get. Decubitus angina. So that means depends upon the positions. So the we increase the venous return or preload by lying down can provoke the pain in the is going to vulnerable patients. So this is going to be in case of the position change also, they may chance to get the pain symptoms according to the venous return or maybe preload. So these are the provocations we can find. And also onset. Onset means, so when they are going to get the start with the pain. So this, if you see the myocardial infarction, so the pain of the myocardial infarction takes several minutes or longer to develop. So it takes the slowly is going to be developed. But in the angina, this pain is going to build up gradually in proportion to the intensity of the exertions. If they exert more, if they stress more, so the pain is going to be increased. If they take the rest, the pain is going to be subside or is going to be less down. And also in case of aortic dissection, massive pulmonary embolism and pneumothorax, the pain very sudden and also is instantaneous. So that means going to be in case of sudden severe chest pain. It may be because of the breakage of the blood vessels. Breakage means the opening of the blood layers that may be leaking from the blood layers because of the aortic dissections. Or maybe is the pulmonary embolism. If the blood rupture, blood clot rupture, and also it transfer from the one place to another place in the bloodstream. If they stuck at one particular place, so because of the stuck at the blood vessels, it may won't supply the blood circulation to the other parts of the tissues. So it may use the, like hypoxia may produce the chest pain. So that also if the sudden chest pain, it may won't give the cardio-related chest pain. And also that is the difference between the MI, that's myocardial infarction. This is the purely like a cardio-related chest pain. So this going to be the, it takes the several minutes and longer to develop. So it's going to be take slowly they're going to develop the pain. So if the sudden means, it's not a cardiac related chest pain. And also musculoskeletal and also psychological pain occurs after the exertions. So exertions means if they did the activities or if they strain. So if they may get the pain means it's related to the musculoskeletal and also psychological test. So psychological related the chest pain. So in its associated features, the associated features are going to be, just now we discussed, if anybody having cardio related pain or chest pain, the associated symptoms are going to be the autonomic nervous system is going to be disturbance. So because of the autonomic system involvement, they will get the sweating and vomiting and also nausea. Nausea means the vomiting sensation. So the some people may chance to get the vomiting sensation as well as may chance to get the vomiting. And also breathlessness. So it's going to be the pulmonary congestion. So the lung is because of the congestion from the transient ischemic left ventricular dysfunction. If any problem in the left ventricle, if there is no pumping action, so they may, because of the decrease the blood circulation, if there is no pumping action, so they may chance to get the breathlessness. So these are the associated features along with the cardiogenic chest pain. So coming to the, if you see the characteristics and also the ischemic cardiac related and also non-cardiac chest pain. So if you differentiate here, we can clearly understand the what is the cardiogenic pain and also what is the non-cardiogenic pain. So for example, location. So location will be in the center. So it indicates the central and also diffuse. Only in the central regions here is going to be is related to the ischemic cardiac pain. But is the peripheral and also localized. Peripheral means if it is going to the sides, to the chest, or maybe is the right hypochondrium and also epigastric level. So maybe it comes to the right side or left side. So is there is no the exactly. So that means in the peripheral and localized also. It's not, it's only one place. But in the chest one is going to be diffuse, center is going to diffuse through this side. So it's going to be distributed. So this gut is going to be the ischemic heart diseases. And also radiating pain. So in the radiating, the heart related like a cardiogenic chest pain or ischemic cardiac pain. So radiating to the jaw and radiating the neck, shoulders and also arms, and sometimes it's going to reach to the backside. But in case of the non-cardiogenic chest pain, so the pain is not going to radiating, is a localized, only one particular one place may chance to get. And also if you see the characters, so it's going to be the is a tight and squeeze and choking. So it's going to be like in the center. So just now we discussed, right, how they're going to be crushing in over the chest, or if anybody is sick, or if they are hit with a hammer, so with a high pressure, so they are going to feel who are going to get the cardiogenic chest pain. And also in the non-cardiogenic, or is going to be the non-cardiac chest pain. So it's going to be the only sharp and stabbing and also catching type of pain. So that means not that much of tightness, not a severe tightness or discomfort in the during the non-cardiogenic chest pain. And also is the precipitations. So when they are going to get the more severe. So in the exertions and also emotions are going to be increasing the chest pain. And also this one is going to be spontaneous, provoked by the posture, respiration and also palpitations. So if they change the postures, if any change the respiration, like if they breathe in and breathe out, or maybe the palpitations, so it may alter if they're getting any palpitation, abnormal, like the heart rate or rhythm, so it may alter the pain intensity also. And also relieving factors. So how they are going to get the reliefness. So if they take the rest and quick response to the nitrates. So if they take the nitrates, the medications, so is aspirin and also any isosorbitrate, any medication, especially the nitrates, if they take the medications, so they are going to get the relief. So these medications will improve the blood circulations and also improve the chest, that's improve the oxygen levels to the muscles. So we can, they are going to get the relief. But this one is going to not relieved by the rest. So if they take the rest, are slow or no response to nitrate. So if they take the medications through the orally and also sublingually under the tongue, if they keep this one, so these who are having cardiogenic chest pain, they will get the relief. The muscular pain related or non-cardiogenic type of the pains, so they won't get any relief from the nitrates. And also associated features. So these associated features are going to be with the chest cardiac pain, the cardiac chest pain, they may chance to get the breathlessness. But in the non-cardiogenic, they are going to get the respiratory problems and also gastrointestinal and also locomotor or psychological. So they are going to get the along with the other complications, maybe musculoskeletal or maybe because of the gastric irritation. So what is the differential diagnosis for the chest pain? So differential diagnosis, just now we discussed so many varieties of the chest pain due to so many cause factors. So is chest pain is due to anxiety or emotion? So who are having some stress, anxiety and depressions, so those people feel always the chest pain or because of the emotion. And also cardiac related, so it's because of the any involvement of the like a heart blood vessels and also the oxygen supply and blood supply to the heart muscles. So this is also one of the cause to factor. And also aortic one, because of the dissections or maybe any stenosis, esophagus, and also any lung or pleura, musculoskeletal, or because of the neurological. So these are all the differential diagnosis. So it will be very, just now we discussed, so we are going to discuss one by one here. So in the anxiety, so this also common cause for the atypical chest pain. So they having any anxiety and depressions may chance to get. So that is mainly the lack of relationship with the exercise. So if anybody having unable to, if they are sedentary lifestyle, so if there is no like exercise, if they are not doing regular exercise, so and also if there is anything with any receiving any bad news. So if any bad news, if there is no proper exercise, or if there are the anxiety and depressions, so those people are may chance to get the chest pain. And also another one is the cardiogenic. So just now we discussed that related to the myocardial ischemia, and that is the blood circulation. And also myocarditis, that is inflammation of the muscles, pericarditis, mitral valve prolapse. And also another one is the pain in the felt and the retrosternally to the left to the sternum, or in the left or right shoulders. So if anybody having the shoulder pain, and also retrosternally, so behind the sternum, and also intensity varies with the movement and also phase of the respirations. So they may chance to get the sharp and may catch during the inspirations, or coughing in the lying, in the if they flat lying down, so they will get the cardiogenic pain. And occasional history of the predominant viral illness also may chance to get the this myocarditis, and because of the pericarditis, it's inflammatory. So especially for the inflammations, so they are going to get the chest pain. So that is the difference between the heart and also the non-cardiac conditions. And also this aortic one, just now already discussed, the aortic dissections and also aortic aneurysms. So this going to pain is severe, sharp, and also tearing sensations, and also penetrating through the back. So it's going to be abrupt onset. Pain follows the path of the dissections. So how the dissections takes place, how the bleeding, so how the leaking is going to be happen. So they are going to get the severe pain along the pathway of the dissections. So if a dissection, so here is going to be three types of the dissections, how the dissections is going to be happening. So there they are going to get the that means the bleeding. So how is going to be happening? So how much the, which directions is going to get? So that the area is they are going to get the pain. And also next one is the esophageal. So esophageal means is because of the any like a, the food pipe, you tell nothing but the food pipe. If any abnormality in the food pipe, so they may chance to get the chest pain. So these are all the, especially is the any inflammation of the esophagus, that is the food pipe, or any spasm, so any tightness of the any smooth muscle tightness, or any is a Mallory vasus syndrome. So and also pressure, tightness, and also they may chance to get the burning. So they feel the pain in the retrosternal, behind the sternum, they are going to feel the more pain. There is not, it won't be like a diffuse, it's a localized pain. And also it's a mimic like a angina, it's very closely. So this condition is like how the, in the angina chest pain they are going to feel. So it looks like it's angina pain, but sometimes precipitated by the exercise. So if any, so it's going to aggravate or it's going to be with the exercise. So sometimes relieved by the nitrates. So this also, so some is going to be, if they take sometimes the nitrates and medications, it may give the reliefness. Illustrate the history of the chest pain to supine posture, or is the eating, drinking, or esophageal reflex. So they may chance to while doing the like a, having food or having drinks. So that time also they may chance to get the in the supine positions. So they may chance to get the esophageal reflex. So this may kick or regurgitate. The pressure is going to come from the stomach to the esophagus. So it, they may chance to get the burning sensation. So they may feel the regurgitation force in the chest. So that is because of the esophageal reflex. And also sometimes this may radiating to the backside. So because of the irritation of the mucosa, so may chance to give the back irritation. It may radiate to the backside. and also because of the lung and also pleura. So pleura is a covering layer of the lung. So any spasm, bronchospasm, any restriction because of the any congestion in the lung or any pulmonary infarct or any decrease of blood circulation in the lung, or in case of pneumonia, infection, a tracheitis, inflammation of the trachea, and pneumothorax, air enter into the pulmonary pleura, and also pulmonary embolism, if any blood clot is a break and also is traveling in the bloodstream and stuck at one particular place, or any malignancy or any tuberculosis. So these are the causative factors for the lung pain due to like a lung diseases. Bronchospasm, so this is going to be irreversible. Airway obstruction in case of the asthma, so or in case of the exertional chest tightness, so that also relieved by the rest. So in these conditions, they may chance to get the chest pain. So especially in the pneumonia and pleuritis also, they may chance to get the sharp type of chest pain. So these are the differential type of the chest pain compared to the, if you compare with the cardiogenic and also non-cardiogenic chest pain. So next one is the musculoskeletal. So the musculoskeletal, so these like any injuries such as any rib fracture or any injury, any accidents, or in case of osteoarthritis or any costochondritis. So that means the inflammation of the costal and also is and also next one, the intercostal muscles, any the rib, if any muscles attached to the ribs. So these intercostal muscles injury or is any myalgia is so may chance to get the this musculoskeletal pain. And also this pain or this aching is variable in site and also intensity. So the site is going to be totally different. The intensity will vary, depends upon the cardiac and also non-cardiac disease. So it may vary with the posture and movements. So if they change the posture, abnormal posture, they may chance to get the like intensity and also the way variations may happen in the pain intensity. And also in the movement, if they do the arm movements and overhead activities, any sudden twisting or bending activities make use of this severe pain. And also it can be accompanied by the local tenderness over the rib or costal cartilage. If you press over the chest regions, so it gives the tenderness. So it will give the, if you press, they are going to get the feel the pain. So that is called as tenderness. So these injuries are related to the everyday activities or viral infections. So this is going to be because of the improper activities or the sudden any exercise modifications, the first time initial first day exercises also may chance to give the like a chest like a tenderness, or maybe is because of the like a strain or stress may chance to get the pain in the musculoskeletal. So and also neurologically, so it's because of the herpes zoster, so they may chance to get the viral viral infections, that is herpes zoster virus. So this also may give the sharp and burning sensations. So this also may produce the pain in the chest region. And also in case of the prolapsed intervertebral disc, so any disc prolapse, so the nerve is going to be compressed. So because of this thing also, it may radiating to the chest, it may give some chest pain. So these are the some neurological diseases, especially in disc prolapse and also herpes zoster. Thoracic outlet syndrome. In thoracic outlet syndrome, the nerve is going to be compressed between the subclavian muscles. The thoracic nerve is going to be in. So it also produces the pain in the chest as well as the radiating pain into the upper limbs. So these are the causative factors because of the neurological disorders. And also next one is going to be the stable angina versus acute coronary syndrome. So how we are going to differentiate with the stable angina and also we are going to see the acute coronary syndromes. The stable angina, so if you see here, so what are the features? So the comparison between the stable angina and also acute coronary diseases. The pathophysiology, if you see the pathophysiology, so the coronary, acute coronary syndromes are going to be like a thrombus formations or maybe any rupture, so may chance to get the acute coronary. So this one is going to be stable, means inside the fat accumulations, because of fat accumulations, the blood vessel is going to become narrowing. So because of the narrowing, the blood circulation is going to decrease to the muscle tissue. So it may chance to get the severe chest pain. So if you see the pathophysiology, is going to be the fixed stenosis. The fixed stenosis means because of the fat accumulation, the blood vessels, the wall structure is going to be narrow. So it's going to decreasing. This is going to space is going to be decreased. The blood circulation flow also going. The pressure is going to be increased. So may leads to the decrease the blood circulation to the tissues. It may produce the chest pain. And also stable fibrous plaques. So if you see here the fibrous plaques, the fat plaques are going to be stable. So but it is going to be gradual. This the gradual changes. But in case of acute coronary syndromes, so it's going to be dynamic stenosis. Dynamic stenosis means already they having the fat depositions. So these fat depositions again is going to get the any clot or any bleeding or any maybe is going to be stuck here. So is any plaques are going to be ruptured. So if any rupture of the plaques, so it is going to stuck in between the like a stable plaques, so it may use the decrease the blood circulations. So that is the pathophysiology of the stable angina and also acute coronary syndrome. The clinical features are, if you see the clinical features, so this is going to be the demand-led ischemia. So this is going to be the ischemia is there, so they are going to get and also chest pain. Related to the effort and also predictable symptoms over long term. So these people are going to be like a they get the chest pain, but this is going to be a long term. So it is a chronic symptom they are going to feel, and if they take some medication, it is going to be subside. Again, they may get the pain because of this is the stable changes. But here is going to be the supply lead ischemia. So it is going to be suddenly they are going to get the decrease in blood circulations. So symptoms also they are going to get the rest. Is unpredictable symptoms over the short term, within the short is acute conditions they are going to get the symptoms, and also frequent also nocturnal symptoms. So they are going to get the time to time and also frequently they are going to get the symptoms. So these are the difference between the stable and also acute coronary syndrome. The risk assessment here is going to be, so we have to find the symptoms on minimal exertions. So this one is the duration of exercise, degree of ECG changes, abnormal BP response, and also CT coronary angiogram. So with this one easily we can find the, so where exactly having the problem. So with the ECG changes, any blood pressure changes, and also if you do the CT scan or angiogram, so we can rule out the causative factor easily. But here is ECG changes at the rest we have to found it. ECG changes with the symptoms and also elevation of the troponin. So we have to check the any troponin level is increased or any changes in the ECG. So these things we have to compare in case of the acute stable angina and also acute coronary syndromes. So if you relate, if you see the comparisons here is going to be unstable. So here stable angina, the effort related chest are choking in the chest. So they may chance to get the choking and also relationship to the physical exertions. They may chance to get the chest pain. The duration of the symptoms should not be noted because patients with the recent onset angina are the greater risk. So they are going to be the recent angina, they are going to get the more like symptoms. So here acute coronary syndromes are going to be urgent evaluations because of sudden onset. So there is maybe the prolonged and severe cardiac like a chest pain. So they have to differentiate. Stable one is going to be the stable, that means they can get the pain and also this is going to be subside with the nitrates, and this one is going to be sometimes they may won't get in the with the nitrates. So these are the difference between the stable and also is acute coronary syndromes. So the physical examination is going to be the risk factors we have to identify. Is there any xanthoma indicates any hyperlipidemia, so that means fat accumulations, any left ventricular dysfunctions, or any like is a dyskinetic, the apex beat, gallop rhythm. So all these things we have to identify, and also if anybody having any peripheral vascular diseases, and also untreated conditions may exhibit angina. So because of the peripheral like a vascular disease also may chance to produce the unstable angina. And acute coronary syndromes, we have to do the according to the signs and symptoms, such as the like any comorbidity risk factors related to the like a peripheral vascular and also cerebrovascular diseases, or maybe any autonomic disturbances such as the pallor or maybe paleness or sweating, and also complications such as the any abnormal rhythm of the heart, that is arrhythmias, any SA node or AV node conduction block, so may produce the sudden or acute coronary syndromes or is unstable as anginas. So what is the difference between, so here is unstable anginas, the coronary artery diseases, aortic valve diseases, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, angina, murmurs, echocardiography. So these are going to be under the stable angina. And here the blood test should be, you have to go for the blood analysis, full blood count, and also the sugar levels, fasting blood sugars, lipids, and also TFTs and 12-lead ECG, exercise testing, coronary angiogram. So if anybody confirm with a stable angina, so they have to like a total permanent lung function test and also coronary angiogram is a, so they have to go for the evaluation. So coming to the acute coronary syndromes, so hemodynamics, so they have to check for the is any signs of the hemodynamics such as hypotension, pulmonary edema, and also for them we have to immediately do the ECG test, any ST segmental elevations, so and also any biochemical markers, that is troponin elevations, and also in case of the we have to do the 12-lead ECG, or any changes in the new ECG changes, elevated plasma troponin concentration, confirm the diagnosis of an acute coronary syndromes. And also exercise test or CT coronary angiogram to diagnose the underlying coronary heart disease. So for them also we can do the CT scan of the coronary angiogram, and also for mainly rule out the any coronary artery diseases. So these things just now we discussed. So which type of the pain we can predict the what is the cause to factors. So here you can easily understand, so what type of the cause to factors is going to give the clear information, the picture. But if, for example, if you see the angina, the duration of the symptoms are going to be the 2 minutes, are going to be the less than 10 minutes. So the pressure is going to be the tightness, pressure, heaviness and burning. And also the location is the retrosternal, is often with the radiation to the or isolated discomfort in the neck, a jaw or shoulders. So is frequently the left side. So this is going to commonly seen in the angina. So, and also the precipitating factors are going to be the exertions, or in case of any exposure to the cold, any psychological stress. So the sound, the heart sound gallops and the mitral regurgitations, the murmur during the pain. So we can found heart sound 4, we are going to found at the mitral regurgitations, murmur during the pain. So we can found associated features are there. Is an unstable angina is going to be the 10 to 20 minutes, similar to the angina, but is going to be the severe pain compared to the stable angina. So it's also same like the retrosternal, and also same like is going to be like the angina symptoms. But the low levels of exertion or even the rest also, they're going to feel the pain in the unstable angina. In case of acute MI, myocardial infarctions, so it's going to be is more than 30 minutes. So if anybody having pain less than 10 and also 20 minutes, so we can feel, we can predict this is related to the angina. But in case of the acute MI, if it will be more than 30 minutes, if more than 30 minutes, so the symptoms are going to be the angina, but severe, like we already discussed how they are going to beat with the hammer and also squeezing and crushing. So the type of symptoms are going to be feel. So same, the pain also is going to be retrosternal, and also this is unrelieved with the nitroglycerin, maybe associated with the heart failure and also arrhythmias. So this is the difference between the unstable angina and stable angina, also is a myocardial infarction. So next one is the aortic stenosis. So if the duration is going to be recurrent episodes, so there is no constant. So sometimes they're going to feel the pain, and also sometimes it's going to be relapsing. So same, the pain also same like an angina, but the location, the same location also same, the retrosternal, and associate features are the late, then also peaking systolic murmur radiating to the carotid arteries. So it's going to give the radiating to the carotid arteries. And also these symptoms also like a pericarditis, these are hours to days, maybe episodic, they're also going to get the hours to days, so may chance because of the inflammatory conditions, because of the inflammation of the pericardium, so they may chance to get the severe pain, so it days to hours to days together. So the pain also is like a, not like a same angina, but it's a sharp like pain. It is not like a tightness or heaviness, but they feel the sharp like pain. So they will get the retrosternal towards the cardiac apex. So that is cardiac apex is the fifth intercostal space. So if you speed that space between the rib cage, the fifth intercostal space, the apex is there. So there they are going to get the more pain in case of the pericarditis. So it may be relieved by the sitting up and also leaning forward, the pericardial friction rub. So this is going to be relieved with the positional changes. They may chance to get the less pain. Coming to the aortic dissections, the abrupt onset and also unrelenting pain. So they're going to get the like a tearing pain, ripping sensation, like a knife, like how they with the cut with a knife. So they are going to feel the like a pain, like a knife cut. And also it is going to anterior chest, often radiating to the back between the shoulder blades. So it's going to get the anteriorly and also mostly is going to distribute to the in between the shoulder blades. The associated features are hypertension, underlying connective tissue disorders, and Marfan syndrome. So they may associated with the aortic dissections. And also pulmonary embolism. So these are also is an abrupt onset, several minutes to a few hours. So this is going to be the pruritic symptoms. The pleura is going to inflame, how there's like a their severe sharp like pain. So this often lateral to the side of the embolism. So often lateral. So for example, is going to be away from the body. So it goes the side of the embolism. If the side, if you go to right side, so it's my right side, it's my left side, but towards the lateral side. So because of this embolism, so they may chance to get the dyspnea, tachypnea, that is difficulty in breathing, increasing the like a breath rate, and also tachycardia, heart rate is going to be increased, and may chance to get the hypotension, decreasing the blood pressure also they may chance to get. These are the associated features with the pulmonary embolism. Next one is the pulmonary hypertension. So the pain is going to be the variable. Is a pressure, they are going to get the substernal along with the associated features of the dyspnea. Signs of the venous pressure including edema and also and jugular venous distension. So they will get the distension in the jugular vein. So these are the physical features of the pulmonary hypertension. So pulmonary pruritic, pneumonia and pruritis is going to be variable. And also pruritic symptoms, unilateral is a localized one, dyspnea, difficulty breathing, cough, fever, rails, and occasional rubs are going to found in the pneumonia. So these are the associated features. And also spontaneous hypertension. So the pain is going to be sudden onset and also maybe several hours may chance to get. It's also pleuritic pain towards the lateral side. So side of the pneumothorax. If any pneumothorax means is related to the any air enter into the pleural cavity. So may chance to get the this pain. So these are also will get the difficulty in breathing and also difficulty in the decrease the breath sounds. And also side of the pneumothorax. So if the right side pneumothorax, if the air enter into the right side, so that side the breath sounds are going to be decreased. And also use of gasal reflex. So it will be the 10 to 60 minutes. So because of the gastric problem, so they will get the burning and also substernal and also epigastric. So in between the sternal and also epigastric level at the stomach gastric levels. And also it is worsened by the is a postprandial. So after the food, they are going to get the calm, like a severe pain. Or maybe the sleeping recumbency and also recumbent relieved by the antacid. If they take the antacid medications or pantoprazole or omeprazole, so are syrups also may relieve the antacid syrups also may relieve the pain. And also next one is the use of axial spasm. 2 to 30 minutes, so it may chance to get, they may feel the pain like a pressure, tightness and burning. So the pain also in the retrosternal I can closely mimic like an angina. Because of the spasm, the muscles are going to be constricted. This looks like is the angina symptoms. Peptic ulcers. So this is going to be prolonged. So that means that there is no continuations. So always the burning sensation at the exactly the epigastric region and sternal level. So it's the same like is the esophagus reflex, but esophagus is a little bit the substernal. So it's epigastric in the gastric level. So and also relieved with the food or also antacid. Sometimes if they take the proper food, so if the less spicy or also maybe is the cool food, so may chance to get the control or like a yogurt or maybe with the like a cool food means like a whatever the probiotic food. So which one is going to be stop the irritation, so that food and also antacids are going to relieve the this type of chest pain. And also in case of gallbladder diseases, so it's going to be prolonged and also burning and pressure is going to be epigastric and also it may follow the meal. If they take the meal, so the pain is going to be increased. And musculoskeletal is going to be variable, so it may aching pain, so aggravated by the movements. And also next one is the herpes zoster. It is also variable, sharp like pain. So it may vesicular rash, that is the vesicles are going to be gives the pain. And also emotional one, so is going to be variable. So maybe situational factors, so anxiety or depression, so often detectable with the careful history. So if you take the history properly, so we can rule out the like emotional type of the chest pain. So these are all the different types of the chest pain, the locations and characteristics and association of the chest pain. So if you know, understand about the different type of the chest pain, their location and also associated features, we can easily differentiate to the cardiac chest pain. So if you rule out the cardiac chest pain and also non-cardiac chest pain, so we can prevent the mortality and we can prevent the heart diseases. But who have like a gastric problem and also like a esophageal problem, so they should not take the like a they should not feel like it's a cardio related pain. So that's why you should not bother about the seriousness or maybe. But if they take the medication, proper medication related to the causative factor, so we can prevent the chest pain. So all chest pains are not cardio related, so should not be panic. So rule out the causative factor, take the treatment according to the causative factor, so we can prevent the serious complication related to the heart problem. So that's all about the chest pain and also differential diagnosis. So this will help to rule out the cardiogenic chest pain. So that's all about today's topic. In the next class, we will discuss another topic. So if you have any doubts related to this topic, you can send me a message. So I can give the clarification about your doubts. So that's all about your topic. Thank you very much.